gather together as Lakeview Christian Church, it is good to come together in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
I want to let you know about a few things as we get started this morning. First of all, this afternoon is our turn to host the worship service at Lake Placid Health and Rehab Center. If you'd like to be a part of that, that service is at 2, but please be there at 1:45 so we have time to get everybody checked in and set up and whatnot. Chat and Shoe will be tomorrow night at Casa Tequila Restaurant at 5:30. You can contact Becky Hamlin, who's back there waving, and her number is also in the bulletin if you'd like to come to that. Again, this is not a set group. This is a free-for-all, which is sort of what it feels like. Well, no, let me rephrase. You do have to pay for the food. So free may not be the right word, but it's just people getting together. And so this is a great opportunity to come, to get to meet some people, to get to know some folks that maybe you've sat on opposite sides of the sanctuary for a while and haven't really had a chance to connect. And so this is a great opportunity to do that. I'd encourage you to come. It's a fun time together. Next Sunday will be our monthly prayer time at 4 p.m. over in the Lighthouse. We've got a small group of us that are getting together to intercede and pray for our community, for the church, for God to bring revival, and for God to bring home the lost. If you are a person of prayer, I would highly encourage you to come join us for that time. We will be collecting next Sunday and the following non-perishable food items for Manna Ministries, who just had their anniversary in open house this last week. We'll be collecting that at the end of the month. Non-perishable goods you can also drop off at the church office through the week. And one thing I would encourage you to do is please make sure you're bringing stuff that's in date. A lot of times what we do is we go into our pantries and we say, this is stuff I haven't used in a while. Let me take it to the food bank. Except if it's out of date, they can't use it either. So a lot of times what I've seen people do is take advantage of BOGOs. Do you need 2 cans of corn? Maybe you get one for yourself and one for the mission. So just different things you can do like that. But do make sure what you're bringing in is not something that is already out of date or so close to it that we won't actually get to people in time. Finally, we're going to have at the end of the month a volunteer appreciation lunch, Sunday, April 28th. Immediately following the service, we will dismiss and all go that way instead of going that way. And it will be a spaghetti and meatball salad, garlic bread, and dessert. We will have sign up next Sunday, and what you'll do next Sunday is basically on the attendance pads as they come down the row, you will just indicate, I think I'm bringing just myself, I think there's 4 of us, I think there's 7 of us, whatever have you. And everyone is invited. With that, let us open in prayer. Almighty God, come into our midst this day. Come here and meet with us. Holy Spirit, pour out on us as we gather together, as we share in worship and in word, as we seek you in prayer and offer ourselves. Lord, meet us here. Transform us, change us, that we may be a people dedicated to your purpose for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's rise together as we open our service this song.
Thank you.
seated.
Our scripture readings begin this morning in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 50. Hear God's word. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and so we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall the saying Then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Amen. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. And as we do, will you join me as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Christ, you and you alone are our cornerstone. You make us strong in you. You have carried us through trial and storm. You have walked with us through dark nights and bright days. You have been with us in our best and in our worst. And even when we have fallen short of your glory, Lord, you have still loved us, and you have received us when we turned to home. Thank you, God, for your never-ending love for us. Lord, mold us after your image. Lord, we know one day we will be transformed to be even more in your likeness, but even yet still, while we dwell here on earth, shape us to reflect you to the world, that your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, your holiness, your righteousness would be seen in us, and that even in our weaknesses, even in our failures, Lord, you would be shown to be strong in us. Make us more and more your disciples this day. Father, draw those to you who are in need of you, who have fallen away from you, who grew up with an idea of you, but never made you their Lord and Savior. And Lord, for those who have never heard of you at all, draw them to yourself. Lord, open our eyes to see where you're calling us to join you in that drawing, where you want us to share a word, a moment, a thought, a prayer, where we need to just sit in silence with someone and pour out your love to them. But Lord, draw them home to you. Work not only through us as individuals, but as a church. Work through us, God. Move through us and the churches across this community. Lord, we are not by ourselves the kingdom of God, but Lord, you have people all over this community calling out to you this morning. So use us as the body of Christ across Lake Placid, Methodist, Presbyterian, Lutheran, it doesn't matter. Lord, those who call on your name, use us, that we may draw people home to you. Lord, use the ministries that go out from us as well, the Zirkles and the Minguses, Lakeview Christian School and Youth for Christ, Manna and Hui, Potter's House and the Children's Home and Enterprise. Lord, use all of these to bring glory to you and to bring your lost sheep. Father God, we lift up to you those who are in need of you this day. Father God, I lift up to our men and women in the military, Father God, that you would watch over them, Lord. These are contentious times. And Lord, we ask for your protection of them. Lord, we ask for your moving in the situation in Israel right now with this latest attack from Iran, Father God. We ask for your hand to be moving there, Lord, that you would bring about your will, that you would do the work there, that you would use even these times to draw people to yourself. Lord, we give you thanks for your protection around Dave and Donna Kratz, who were hit by a semi this week, but are in good health and are here today. And Lord, we give you thanks for your protection for them. Lord, we continue to lift Leonard Miller up to you for healing and recovery. He's still having complications from his procedures this past week. And so, Lord, we ask for your healing for him. Lord, I lift Mike Mullins up to you, my dad, for restoration and for mobility, Father God, that you would work in his body and bring your healing to him. Lord, I lift up to you praises for Charlotte DeVita, who is recovering well from her surgery. And Lord, we continue to ask for your healing and renewal in her body. Lord, we lift up to Sherman and his kids, Father God, and ask for your hand to be in that situation, that you would move and bring restoration there. And Lord, we lift up to you the family of Ruth Shanley, who passed away on Friday, and ask for your comfort for them, your grace and your mercy for them as they make plans and as they say their goodbyes. Lord, we thank you that she is home with you. This was someone, Lord, that proclaimed you literally to the ends of the earth. And God, we give you thanks for her and her husband's ministry, and Lord, we ask for your comfort now for her family in this time. Lord, we lift all of these up to you and ask that you will meet these needs according to your will and your great riches in glory. Father God, we ask that you will show us how to walk faithfully with you in this week to come, how to see the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil for what they are, and to steer clear. Forgive us when we fall short, and show us how to offer that same grace to others around us as well. Lord, we can't look at their failures and judge them differently than ours any more than you do. And so, Lord, the same grace that you have showed us, teach us how to show to others. Lead us in your ways, guide us in your steps, that all might be to your glory and your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We invite our ushers to come and serve us now as we return a portion of what God's entrusted to us back to him to give him our time.
Yeah.
We're grateful that you can use us to sustain the ministries of this church and your ministry to the world. May you bless all that is given and what is received, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll invite you to stand with me as we sing this next song. We all look forward to the day when we are dwelling in Beulah Land.
Starting in verse 13, I encourage you to follow along in your own Bibles.
Afterwards, as we get into the message, we're also going to be going to Matthew 24 for a bit. We're not going to read that ahead of time, but if you want to kind of slide a bookmark in there, I remember in the days long ago before we had these lovely contrivances on the side here, being the guy who neurotically went through the bulletin and bookmarked every page in the hymnal and every scripture. So if you are like me in that regard, go ahead and slide a piece of paper in Matthew 24 while you're at it. And if not, you crazy people, you can just freewheel it all the way to Matthew 24 when we get there. But hear God's word this morning. But we do not want you to be ignorant or uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the shout of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God. We pray with me. Almighty God, as we open up your word this morning, we ask that you will speak to us. God, whatever it is we need to hear this morning, you know. You know the places where we struggle and the places where we understand, the places where we wrestle and the places where we have overcome. And so, Holy Spirit, come and speak to each of our hearts this morning. Tune our minds, our ears, and our hearts to know your voice and to tell it apart from others. Speak your word to us this day. God, use whatever words I may offer, but you speak to us today, that we may know and do your will and yours alone. Through Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. So we're working our way through challenging passages of the Bible. And when we were in the first phase of this back at the beginning of the year, we talked a little bit about what our state will be in the afterlife, and we sort of rushed past this passage, and I said, look, the rapture is a whole thing unto itself. If you want to get into that, let me know, and we'll come back to it later, and that may have been my first mistake, because somebody, one of my own offspring, afterwards said, hey, can you teach on the rapture next? All right. Let me give you my background and my bias with this. I'm going to put these out here up front because I'm going to tell you of all the things I teach on, this is the week I'm most likely to be wrong. Here's my thing. My initiation to this topic of the rapture and the second coming and the end times and all of these sorts of things did not start well. I was introduced to this concept as an early middle schooler in youth group when our youth leader showed us a movie called Like a Thief in the Night. How many of y'all have seen that movie? It came out in the 1970s. Yeah, a handful of you. I wouldn't immediately put it in your Netflix queues or anything. This was a movie. Okay, how many of y'all are familiar with Left Behind? A little more? The Left Behind series, Tim LaHaye, all that? Same plot line, basically. And both of these pull from a similar theological model that talks about Jesus coming, that there is a rapture, an uptaking of all believers, that they disappear, and then we come into this time of great tribulation and trials, and there's this individual known as the Antichrist or the Beast that rules over everything, and then eventually Jesus comes back again and sets everything right. Now, how this movie portrayed it was less an encouraging reference to scripture and more a scary movie along the lines of Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Jump scares included. There are numerous scenes where somebody is lovingly having a conversation and then their spouse stops talking and you cut over to a shaving razor in an empty sink with nobody standing there and music going da-da! And I spent the next month, okay, I was like 11 in all fairness, but I spent the next month after seeing this movie, if I did not know exactly where my parents were, at any given moment, I was convinced they had been raptured and I was stuck here. Now, it didn't get any better in high school because I had somebody who I went to a conference and they taught on this, and it was a little bit better. It wasn't as fear-laden, but it was still, to me, confusing. And this guy started trying to tie everything in Revelation to things that were happening in the news at that moment. So the Great Plague was AIDS, and the locusts were helicopters, and all of these different things, and I came home again very confused. What I have come to learn about myself over the years, and this is where my bias comes in. If you can show me something plainly in Scripture, I'll go with you there. If you bring an idea to Scripture and you give me an outline and you say, if you go to this Scripture, this Scripture, this Scripture, this Scripture, and this Scripture, you will see how this outline works, I'm more skeptical. It doesn't mean you're wrong. It just means you're going to have to work harder to convince me, which ultimately may not be worth that much anyway, it's just me. But it means that when we get to conversations about the end times, which very much involve connecting Daniel to 1 Thessalonians, to Revelation, to things that Jesus says in 3 out of the 4 Gospels, it falls under my list of hard passages of the Bible. I feel like I'm in good company. John Wesley, who's the guy who founded this whole Methodist movement, wrote a full Bible commentary, except for when he got to the book of Revelation. And if you read the preface to his commentary on Revelation, John Wesley, the founder of an entire movement within Christianity, great scholar, great organizer, says, I didn't really feel up to the task of writing this. I used somebody else's book instead. I don't know if that means that John Wesley also cheated on his exams, I don't know. But the thing is that there are really a handful of main viewpoints. Now, there are a few things that say that all of this language is metaphorical, that this was coded language in Revelation and things that Matthew is recording of Jesus' words, that this is all stuff that was just happening in their day, it's all over with, that was the past. It's very hard to make that case because there's a lot of things that are clear in black and white in prophecy that haven't happened yet. And if this is the return of Christ, if we're living under Christ's reign now, he's not doing a great job because evil is clearly running rampant in our world. Do I need to convince anybody of that before we go on? No. Okay. We're good with the fact that evil is really actively at work right now, yes?
Yes.
Okay. Then there's the question of how does Jesus' second coming then happen? We know he's coming back. We just declared it a few minutes ago in the Apostles' Creed. We know he's coming back. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. How does that work? And where does the church get taken up in all of this? And that's where a lot of the questions come in. And the problem is that no matter what way you answer it, it's a bit complicated. And teachers that I trust, teachers that I have sat under either personally or listened to their lectures recorded or whatever have you, people that I think have a really sound grasp on the Bible, who take Scripture seriously as God's revealed word to us, who don't dismiss it, who don't write it off, who don't say, maybe this is God, maybe this part isn't, people who have the exact same view of Scripture that I do, have completely opposite views on this. That having been said, I want to take a look at a couple of the ones that I've spent the most time with. This is something I'm still working through. I'd love another 6 years before preaching on this, frankly. So maybe we'll come back to it again in 6 years if we hang out together that long. Please say yes. Really and truthfully, this is something that calls us to dig. And to keep testing, and to keep digging, and to, as much as possible, lay aside our biases and our prejudices, and go, what does God's word say? So, the two sides that I have seen generally fall under the name of pre-tribulation and post-tribulation. Those are big words, so let's talk about what those mean. We have what we just read about in 1 Thessalonians 4, that there will come a moment at the cry of the archangel, at the last blast of the trumpets, the dead in Christ will rise, and that the rest of us who are still alive will be caught up together with them to meet with Jesus in the air. This is the event that we call the rapture. The Greek word here, harpazo, is just, it's a taking up, it's a catching up. The Latin word, I think it's rapture or something like that, is where we get the word rapture from. But it's this idea that, yes, at a certain point in the future, it clearly has not happened yet, at a certain point in the future, everyone who was a believer in Christ, who has died, will be raised up from the dead. And anybody who is still walking and breathing oxygen will then be pulled up into the clouds to join them. This matches with what we see described in Jesus' return. If you look at Acts chapter 1, when Jesus has his last conversation with his disciples and then ascends up into the clouds, the disciples are standing there gaping for several minutes trying to figure out what's just happened. And an angel comes up to him and says, "Why are you still standing here? As you've seen Jesus taken up like this, he's going to come back in the same way." So this event is connected to Jesus' return somehow. The question is, when? The two views are pre-tribulation, that it happens, that there's going to come a period of great trial, great judgment upon the earth, and great persecutions. We see this, we're going to look at this in Matthew in a few minutes, and a better chunk of the book of Revelation covers these judgments coming upon the earth. The one view is that God is going to come back for his church before that happens, that he is going to take up those who have died in Christ and those who are still alive in Christ and pull them out of the world before the judgments hit. That there may be those who come to Christ during all of that, that will then face persecutions, but that then Jesus will make a final return and get rid of evil, create the new heaven and the new earth, and set everything right for eternity. That's the pre-tribulation. The post-tribulation view is that there's nothing to say that Jesus is going to take us out first. That we will have to go through this season of persecution and of divine judgment with everybody else. We may be protected from it in some other ways, but that we will go through this season, and then when Jesus comes back, our taking up is a part of him coming into the world, that we're going to go up to meet him and then walk back in with him. That's the overview. Let me delve into those a little bit deeper. Everybody good so far? Questions? Anybody confused yet?
Yeah.
Darn. Okay. Let's see what we can do. Both 1 Thessalonians 4 and 1 Corinthians 15 that we were reading about are talking about the resurrection to come. Paul is writing to these two churches in slightly different circumstances. In 1 Corinthians, he's got a church where people have been sowing this idea that there is no resurrection. Maybe these are leftovers from, or carryovers from the Sadducees, because they didn't believe in the resurrection and angels or miracles or anything like that. Maybe this is a group of false teachers. There was a group at that point that was starting to teach that flesh is bad, spirit is good, and so why would God stick us back into flesh when he's already got us in spirit? That's a group we see Paul arguing with a lot. Perhaps it was those guys. But this church has had people telling them there is no resurrection. And Paul is telling them, number one, if there's no resurrection, then Jesus hasn't been resurrected. And if Jesus hasn't been resurrected, you're still dead in your sins and our faith is futile. We've talked about that one before. But he also says, look, here's the good news. There is going to be a resurrection. That those who have died will be raised again for the day of judgment. But that those who are in Christ will be brought back to eternal life. And if any of us are still walking around and talking and breathing at that point, we're going to join him. 1 Thessalonians 4 comes at it from the other direction. People were worried about the people who had died. They were anticipating Jesus to show up at any minute, and some of their brothers and sisters were already passing away. Several of the apostles had already been executed, and they're like, well, what about those guys? Are they going to miss Jesus coming back? And Paul's writing them to say, no. They're going to get to experience it with us. But Jesus is going to raise them from the dead first, and then we're all going to greet him together. Both of these mention a last trumpet call. Both of these tie it to that particular event. I mentioned Matthew 24 earlier. Let's take a look at that. Matthew 24 is kicked off by Jesus being asked by his disciples about a side comment that he makes while they're in Jerusalem. They are walking around, they're playing tourists, and they're looking and they're going, aren't these buildings magnificent? Isn't this great architecture? And Jesus says to them, I've got news for you. These are all going to collapse to the ground. Not one stone will be left upon another. And so, Peter, Andrew, James, and John pull Jesus aside afterwards and say, okay, what were you talking about? What's going on here? And so Jesus begins to lay out a series of events that seem to both be about the siege of Jerusalem in 70 AD and the destruction of the temple, but also talking about his return, which they don't even quite know that he's leaving yet. But he starts talking to them about that. And he starts going through a series of things that will happen, signs and whatnot that will be to come. And let's go over there real briefly here. Matthew 24, he talks about signs of the end of the age. He talks about that many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and they will lead many astray. So there's going to be impersonators. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place, but the end is not yet. I'm going to tell you, these are pretty relatable so far. Because I've had a fair number of opportunities over my lifetime to have people tell me that Jesus is coming back and here's when it's going to happen. And they've been wrong. Some of y'all are old enough, myself included, to remember that there were a lot of prophecies around the year 1988 that Jesus was going to come back then. Some of y'all remember prophecies about the year 2000 that Jesus was going to come back then. More of you are likely to remember that in 2012 we had a whole bunch of billboards going up all over the place about Jesus' imminent return, not once but twice that year. And even this past week, although it was not as loud and proud as some of the previous rounds, maybe because of how those went, there was at least a small group out there that was thinking that the solar eclipse was one of the last signs prior to Jesus' coming. And so we have a lot of proclamations. Christ is just around the corner. Now here's the thing. He is coming back. Jesus is coming back. But we've also had a lot of people saying, and he's just on the other side of this date. We can relate to that. We can relate to wars and rumors of wars. We have been through numerous wars in the Middle East over the last few decades, and we're looking at some pretty scary stuff happening in Jerusalem, or in Israel, right now. One of the things that Jesus does mention is armies surrounding Jerusalem. I gotta say, that one makes me stop and pause. Because there are attacks coming in from multiple directions at Israel right now. Does that mean Jesus is coming back this week? Not necessarily, but it does make me pay attention to the news. talks about famines and earthquakes in various places. These are but the beginning of the birth pains, Jesus says, back in Matthew 24. They will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. Many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. I can't help but think some of those things are happening even right now. We have seen over the last 20 centuries numerous rounds of persecution against Christians, some of which are still ongoing to this day in various parts of the world, some of which are way harsher than anything we've ever experienced on this side of the Atlantic. False prophets leading people astray? Absolutely. The love of many growing cold because lawlessness has increased? I can't tell you how many people have fallen away from Christianity because they have seen sin among Christians and said, well, what's the point? And I can't tell you how many Christians have grown hard in their hearts because they have been trying to stand against lawlessness for so long that they've forgotten how to love. And if you read the book of Revelation, the church in Ephesus had that exact problem. They stood so long on doctrine, which God commends them for, and fought so hard on that, they forgot how to love. These things are ongoing in our lives even now. Then Jesus talks in verse 15 about something called the abomination of desolation, and he points back to the book of Daniel. And in Daniel, there is this prophecy of the abomination that causes desolation. And what Daniel appears to be pointing to happens not many years later, when a Greek ruler by the name of Antiochus IV Epiphanes comes into Jerusalem and sets up an idol in the temple and sacrifices a pig on the altar to Yahweh, which pretty much desolated the place. In fact, and we read about this in the Apocrypha and in the books of the Maccabees, that they took that altar out of there, they broke it apart, and they buried it. Because they weren't really sure what to do with that scenario where this altar to God that had been used for sacrifices for years had just been rendered unclean by this pagan sacrifice. But Jesus also talks about this as being a future event. So Antiochus gives us a model for somebody that is yet to come. And then he begins talking about people fleeing. Is this the fall of the temple in 70 AD or something else? And furthermore, he says after all of this, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened. Now that, eclipses aside, which happen like every 18 months in some part of the world and every 20 years in the West, we've not had the sun fully darkened yet. But he says this, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory, and he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds from one end of heaven to the other. Who are these elect? Well, they're among the ones who may or may not have been led astray a few verses back by false Christs and false prophets performing great signs. The word there is used in other parts of Scripture to talk about those who are called and chosen with Christ and are faithful. God's chosen ones in Colossians 3. Paul, a servant of God and apostle Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect in Titus 1:1. All of these seem to point to the fact that the elect are probably the believers in Christ. Now, that may be a part we can quibble over. I think there's a fair number of teachers out there who would say this would be Israel that Jesus would be coming back for. That's a place where I'm a little less certain. But again, the question is not about whether or not we will be raptured, whether or not we'll be caught up to Jesus, but when it will take place. Some will point to the fact that Jesus refers multiple times to the fact that we will not know when his return will come, to say that the rapture has to take place out of the blue before there's a whole bunch of signs and judgments falling upon the earth. On the other hand, in Matthew 24, he also spends a lot of time talking about the signs and judgments that will take place, and then his return will come, and then follows up with saying, we will not know the day or the hour, but that there will be signs to indicate that it is coming. He says in verse 32, from the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see all of these things, you know that he is near at the very gate. It doesn't say you're going to know the day and the time, but it does say you're going to have a hint when he's getting close to coming. And then he goes on to say nobody's going to know the specific day or hour, just like it was in the time of Noah. Noah knew. Noah knew he needed to prepare. He didn't know necessarily the day the rain would start, but he knew God had told him to prep. Nobody else figured it out. This is not to give fuel to those who pick dates, but it is to say that we will have some indication as things draw closer, and we should pay attention to what's going on around us, because these things are calling us to be alert, to know that Jesus' return is coming soon. Don't let the false predictions discourage you. Again, Jesus himself says that there will be people saying that Christ is over here, he's over there. It's going to happen. Some people will say that God would not allow his church to go through this tribulation. And this is sort of the crux of the argument of the pre-tribulation, that God would not allow the church to go through that because what is coming is a series of judgments upon the earth. And we as Christians would not be judged under that because we are in Christ. They'll point to Revelation chapter 3, verse 10. Because you have kept my word with patient endurance, this is one of the churches, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world to try those who dwell on the earth. So the point in that column is that if these things, if these signs and things falling upon the earth and the kinds of, you know, mountains falling from the sky that we see in Revelation, these things are judgments upon the earth, it would make sense that God would pull his people out ahead of time. Some have also argued that in Revelation chapter 1, you see the church represented by a variety of lampstands, seven specifically representing not only seven churches that Jesus is getting ready to dictate letters to, but sort of the completeness of the church itself. That you see something similar to that up in heaven in chapter 4, although different words are used. So I don't know how clear of a sign that is. You also see in Revelation chapter 7 a whole bunch of people up in heaven who are worshiping the Lord. Revelation chapter 7 verse 9 says this, after this I looked and behold a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, so they're pure and holy, they've been washed by Jesus, with palm branches in their hands, crying out in a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And the verses that come make it very clear that these are those who are coming out of the great tribulation. There is also a third view that says that we get pulled out somewhere in the middle of the tribulation, and this could also potentially support that. But let me bring this to a wrap, because my goal today is not to settle the argument. People have made whole careers out of trying to settle this argument, and I'd hate to put them out of work. No. And this is what I'm still churning through. I'll be honest. I feel like I'm leaning in a direction. Maybe you picked up on it. But I also don't know that I'm right. But here's what I do know is that when Scripture talks about these things, it's not to freak us out. It's not to make us panic. In fact, at the end of this passage in 1 Thessalonians 4, Paul gives a very specific direction about how he wants this to be used. Again, the Thessalonians were worried about those who had already passed on and about what were the things to come. And he says, therefore, encourage each other with these words. Whatever we walk away from Scripture with about Jesus' return, and people who I feel have a solid grasp on God's word and are following him faithfully come to different conclusions about these things, this specific thing. It's meant to encourage us, not to make us afraid. It is meant to call us to look longingly for the return of our Savior, whatever order the events take, to watch for the signs on the horizon. Not with anxiety. We don't mourn like those who have no hope, and we don't watch the news like those who have no hope. Amen? We are watching for Jesus to return because we know he will. We may be among those. You and I, all of us in this room right now, may be among those who, when Jesus returns, rise up to meet with him in the clouds. Or we may be among those who are raised from the dead first and then go to meet him in the clouds. Some of us are closer to one of those than others. That wasn't an age joke, I promise. Because we don't know, do we? We don't know how many days we have left. And so Christ is calling us to have hope in him today, that no matter what comes, no matter what the next 48 hours of news cycles tell us about the Middle East, no matter who gets elected president this fall, Jesus is still coming back to set things right. And we will join him if we are in him. And no matter what trial or tribulation we face, no matter how bad things get, whether we face persecution or just ridicule, whether there are people actively hunting us for believing in Christ, or whether we just get jeered at on the internet, we know that whatever we face, Jesus is still Lord of all. And he is still coming again. And whatever method, whatever pathway, whatever timeline, whatever connection of dots comes to pass, we will be with him. Amen. Yes, I've heard all of your watches ding 11. I get it. Let's keep talking about this. Not necessarily in this exact moment. But if you have more questions, because that was a lot of stuff, I'm still working through it too, guys. Let's dig in together. These are the things that should make us crack open our Bibles and go, let me dig deeper. So let's do it together. If you got more things you want to drill down on, let's talk one-on-one. Or let's get a group together and talk about it. But we know for sure, Jesus will be back again. Let's pray. Almighty God, Lord Jesus, come. We say with your Apostle John at the end of Revelation, come soon, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. All of those in heaven are crying out, come soon, Lord Jesus. Those of us on earth are crying out, come soon, Lord Jesus. Jesus, come. Set things right. Bring a final end to death, to sickness, to mourning, to crying, to pain. Break away the old order of things, the old earth and the heaven and the old heaven, and make a new heaven and earth where death is no more, crying and pain and sickness are no more, and the last tears of our eyes have been wiped away by your hands. Lord Jesus, come. In your name we pray. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in his peace.